I heard there's an election coming up. But when I think elections, I think cartograms. Cartograms are like a map chart hybrid. It's not really a map, it's not really a chart, but yeah, of course it's a map. But instead of true geographic area, the area is sized by some bit of data. I'll show you how to make the base layer of a cartogram of the United States' 50 states. All the states are the same size, same shape, arranged about where you'd expect them to be. Here I am in trusty old ArcGIS Pro, and I'm gonna run the generate tessellation tool. A tessellation is a repeating shape with no gaps. I'll tell it to cover the extent of my current map view, which happens to be the contiguous 48 US states. I'll jam in Hawaii and Alaska in a little bit. Everybody knows that hexagons are the best shape for tessellation, but a transverse hexagon is the even better best shape. Now, through much unshown trial and error, I have found that to cover the United States in about 50 shapes, it takes about 150,000 square miles per shape. And then through tedious iterations on a whiteboard, you can determine which shapes correspond to the areas that you want to represent in your cartogram. And I'll just go ahead and select those on my tessellation. And then I'll just right-click my layer and reverse my selection by going to the selection option and saying switch selection. And then I'll go up to the edit tab and then smite these shapes. I don't need them. And remember, always save your work. So once we have our shape, now we can drop some knowledge on them. I'm gonna create a new field in the attribute table called ST for state, like a state abbreviation. And by giving it a state abbreviation, I can do all kinds of table joins and add loads and loads of data to this thing. That's one of the eye-watering beauties of GIS. It's the eye of GIS. Okay, after I've added that field, here's a little bit of tradecraft. I have to sneak up into that Fields tab at the very top and then choose Save. Otherwise, it won't appear. I'm just going to go through manually and put a two-letter state abbreviation for each one of these. And as we go, I'm going to provide a little anecdote for each of these 50 states. I visited Hawaii when I was 14. My mom and I went on a biplane ride over the island of Maui and it was crazy. Oh, also, I'm gonna activate labels for this as I go so it's clear to me which ones I've labeled and which ones I still need to label. My great friend Irfan Ali lives in Texas, and when I went to his wedding in Houston about 15 years ago, which lasted about 3 days, they put me in a chair and lifted it up. My Uncle Bill lives in the Florida Keys, and when he was a young man, he was the caretaker for a personal island, Arizona. One time, I went on road trip to the Grand Canyon in college, and we went rim to rim in the first day. But the first time I saw it was during a government shutdown, and everything was closed. How can the Grand Canyon be closed? On that same college road trip, we visited a shelter in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and painted it. It was called Wings of Hope. Many years later, on a business trip to Tulsa, Oklahoma, I got an all-you-can-eat prime rib dinner and almost exploded. Once I was holding a beer on the sidewalk in the French Quarter of New Orleans, and I was approached by someone dressed as a police officer, and they began writing me a citation. But it was a joke citation and said something like, "Looking too cool." As a teenager, my parents took us on a historical tour of the Natchez Trace in Mississippi. I have been to Alabama, but mostly what I think of is Forrest Gump saying, "Greenbow, Alabama." One time, our family was stranded in the snow along the highway next to Dalton, Georgia, during the storm of the century. When I was 12, my mom took me on a trip to California. It was my first time in an airplane. Drop any random portion of Utah into any other part of the United States and it immediately becomes a national park. Early in my parents' marriage, they visited northern New Mexico. They swore they would come back to live, but instead they stayed in Mount Pleasant, Michigan. One time I did a presentation for a Kansas GIS conference and I made a topographic landscape map of the state, and it's got really interesting topography. In college, I took a course called Environmental Catastrophes, taught by my father, and in it, I wrote a paper about a tornado in Arkadelphia, Arkansas. I like taking my family to Gatlinburg, Tennessee, because I have little kids and we're tourists and it's a tourist trap. And right next door is the Great Smoky Mountain National Park, where we go hiking. 23 years ago, I applied for a job for the town of Hilton Head Island, South Carolina, and I never heard back from them. I wanted it so badly. Charlotte, North Carolina is a beautiful city, but there's a town near me called Charlotte, and it's confusing. I have to think about it every time. Okay, Nelson, don't blow it. Charlotte, 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 Charlotte. I liked traveling to Esri's R&D building in Vienna, Virginia, because I live in Lansing, a bureaucrat town, and there's a plane load of lobbyists that go to DC every morning. It was so convenient. Oregon was the last of the 50 US states that I visited, and I hit it when I was 18 years old. Crater Lake might be my favorite part of the country. Spent the night in Reno, Nevada once on a road trip when I was a kid, and my cousin Karen went out and played the slot machines. She was always very worldly and exciting, owned a monkey, and loved pina colada slurpees. Last year, I got stuck behind an avalanche traveling to Granby, Colorado. I had to drive 4 hours around it. Nebraska makes me think of that great Counting Crows song. Omaha, somewhere in Middle America. I went to a blues festival once in St. Louis, Missouri, and I was amazed to see somebody walking around with a keg strapped to their shoulders and a pump, squirting out beers for $5 a piece. The first keynote I ever gave was in 2017 to the Kentucky Association of Mapping Professionals. I'll forever be grateful to them for that chance. If you look at a map of tornadoes, West Virginia has like this invisible tornado-proof barrier around it. Also, the mountains make it hard to spot and report tornadoes there. When I was a little boy, I wanted to see dinosaur bones so badly. My mom promised we'd go to the Smithsonian, which we did when I was about 14. I don't think she realized that Michigan State University and Michigan both had dinosaur bone exhibits. In grad school, Danielle and I bought a car on eBay Motors in Baltimore and drove there to pick it up, and it was a total lemon. A guy named Ray Romano, I'm not kidding, was selling it, and he made us give him a good review in exchange for backing out. I remember going over the Delaware Memorial Bridge, and I was scared, which is weird because I've been over the Mackinac Bridge, which is way bigger. One time while driving through northern Idaho mountains, we turned a corner and nearly hit a hawk. We both threw on our brakes, and the bird's wingspan was wider than our windshield. I ain't even here, Sergeant. I'm in Cheyenne, Wyoming. In 2018, we camped at a KOA near Rapid City, South Dakota. We went for lunch. 20 minutes later, we came back, and the campground was under about 10 inches of hail. We never even saw a rain cloud. Iowa. Iowa, Iowa, Iowa. Iowa. Once when I was 20 on a trip to Chicago, we saw Julia Roberts walking down the sidewalk. She was much smaller than I expected. My friend Daniel recognized her and pointed at her and said, "It's all you, baby, it's all you, it's all you, baby, it's all you." She gave us a big smile. Indiana. Once in the Indianapolis Children's Museum, we lost my son Juno for like 7 minutes. Terrifying. Years later, Juno and I were hiking off-trail in Hocking Hill State Park, Ohio, and got a ticket for it. One time, the AAG conference was in Philadelphia during St. Patrick's Day, but the whole town partied itself out by like 2. I'd never seen anything like it. In second grade, I had a classmate who had moved to Michigan from New Jersey, and he had such a mysterious accent. It was fascinating. When I lived in Massachusetts, the worst drivers always had Connecticut license plates. I'm sorry, Connecticut. One time at an AAG conference in Seattle, Washington, Ralph Waldo Tobler sat in the front row of my presentation. I was so nervous. He slept through the whole thing. I can't blame him. One time on a hiking trail in Glacier National Park in Montana, my brother Bryce had a brilliant idea. "Hey John, let's jump off this ledge onto the trail below us and Mom will think we're falling off the mountain." And when she came around the corner, we did it and she cried out and dropped to her knees. I'll never forget that sound. I'm sorry, Mom. North Dakota. Okay, here's this. When I lived in Massachusetts, everybody said I sounded like Fargo. I've noticed that in Minnesota, the interstate highways are paved with some reddish-purplish material. What is that? A few years ago, I learned that people in Wisconsin also use their hands for a map. I thought this was just a Michigan thing. I was shocked. Michigan is the state where I live, and it's the one that's actually shaped like a hand. It's surrounded by the Great Lakes, America's inland sea. In the summer of 1999, I was visiting friends in Watertown, New York, and I was sleeping in a Ford Aerostar. Earlier in the day, I threw a scrap of bread to a fox who was following us at a distance down the sidewalk. In the middle of the night, I looked out the window of the Ford Aerostar, and that fox was standing right there in the dark parking lot, patiently waiting, 2 feet away from the Ford Aerostar. That same summer, I was a garbage man on the island of Martha's Vineyard, Massachusetts. To save money, I slept in a camper, and then a barn, and then my car. Did you know that Rhode Island was named Rude Island by a Dutch explorer? It means Red Island. The most fun concert I've ever been to was a cover band called The Nerds playing at the Wobbly Barn in Killington, Vermont. One time, in a middle of the night road trip to Boston, I missed my exit and ended up in Plum Island, New Hampshire. "Well, you're in New Hampshire," said the guy at the gas station. My grandma Shirley wrote a newsletter, it's an early form of social media, for the now defunct motorhome company Champion. She coordinated adventures, they called them fleets, to various parts of the country. And that's how the summers before my first grade year and my fourth grade year were spent caravanning all over Alaska for free. Maine, pine forests, granite, cliffs that fall right into the sea, cold winters. It sounds like my kind of place. I've only been there once, when we took my grandma Lillian on a road trip to the East Coast. And that's 51 anecdotes. Don't forget to save. Here's some data I just got from AAA showing the average gas price per state. I'm going to use that consistent state abbreviation attribute to join these two tables together. So I'll actually add that gas price table to my project. It's a TXT file. Pro tip, it's a good idea not to have any spaces in the headers. And we'll take a look, and yep, there it is, looking good. There's the gas price. So I can go to my hexagon layer, right click, and choose joins and relates, and I'm going to add a join. I'll set this input field to the state abbreviation attribute. And since I only have one table added to this project, it's smart enough to default to that one. And it's also smart enough to default to the right attribute, ST. Let's stitch these tables together and see what we get. I'll close my input table and boom, look at that. My shapes now have attributes. Data. And just like that, our homework is done. We've created our fake geometry. We've breathed data life into it by giving it a unique ID, which is the state abbreviation. And we brought in some actual data and attached it to our shapes. Now we have shapes and meaningful attributes. All that's left is just playing around with visualization, the fun stuff. I'll start by turning off the labels for now, and then I'm going to do some thematic mapping with that gas data. For my primary symbology, I'm going to choose graduated symbols. This means smaller values will appear smaller and larger values will appear larger. It's a nice natural mapping, good way of understanding something. I'll uncheck this option to draw these symbols on top of everything because I'm going to add a second layer later and I want it to render underneath. Instead of a graduated circle symbol, which is the default, I'm going to change this to a hexagon. And so it aligns with my beautifully transverse hexagons. I'm going to give this a rotation of 90 degrees, pointy sides up and down, the cool way. Next, I'll move on to color. Instead of a solid yellow fill, I'm going to give it a gradient fill. And I'd actually like this to look like a cube of gasoline, so I'm going to give it a dark gold color at the top and then a lighter yellowish color at the bottom. Looks kind of 3D this way. And I'll give it an outline color of a darker gold as well, and I'll give it a very thin outline width. And then I'll go back up to the symbology rules, and instead of the tyrannical natural breaks, I'm going to choose equal interval, just a nice even spacing, and I'm going to give it a bunch of classes. Who cares how many number of classes? I just want it to be pretty smooth. And then I'll just play with the maximum size and the minimum size until they look about right. And at this point, we are definitely done with our base map. Thank you for your service, base map. From here on out, I'm just going to do some decoration to give these hexagons a sense of depth. So I'll click on this background option, and instead of a solid fill, I'm going to give this a gradient fill. And instead of a buffered fill, I'm going to make it a linear fill, and I'll set it to continuous instead of discrete because that makes it look smoother and glassy. And I'll set the colors of this gradient from the very lightest gray option to white. And actually, let me hit this flip button because I want the gray to be on top. And now we're going to do some extra credit tricks. I want these floating gas cubes to look like they're casting a little bit of a shadow. So I'm going to add a marker symbol to this. And I'll change its placement setting so it appears just one marker in the center of the hexagon. And I'll make this thing pretty big, 40 points, and I'll give it a negative Y placement to nudge it down. And instead of a solid black circle, I'm going to give it a circular gradient, and it'll go to 100% transparent black at the edge, and then 90% transparent black at the center. And I just like how that looks. So now that we've added a sense of shade, I want to give it a highlight. So I'll duplicate this by holding the control key and dragging. And I'll set its symbology to just basic single symbol, a fill. I'll dig into this and I'll turn off its outline and I'll change its solid fill to a gradient fill. And like before, I'll set that gradient to linear and continuous. And I'll set this highlight gradient to 50% transparent white at the bottom and 100% transparent white at the top. Now I need to scooch this glassy hexagon up so that it looks like it's the lid of my cube. So I'll add a move layer effect, and then I'll just slide it on up in the Y dimension until it looks right. And because I'm effectively offsetting that entire hexagon shape, I'll adjust the gradient to only be like 50% of the distance. And that way I avoid highlights spilling over where they don't belong. And the result is a hexagonal cartogram that looks more like Qbert would be bouncing around on it. And I like that. And I'll share a link to the polygon shapefile of these hexagons, so you can jump right into the data joining and vising.